This was an agnostic Agile meetup event on risk management, a pillar of scaling Agile with Dan Roman on the 1st of October 2020.
A lot of people think that risk management is a sort of mumbo jumbo, fortune teller. Is not. And I hope that I'll convince at least the people in this webinar that it's a very important thing, especially when we speak about scaling Agile. And this word scaling, people forget that has two meanings. One is scaling up, one is scaling down. And very few people in the Agile world know that there is a very huge scale Agile that was started in 90. It's very mature, and they are trying to scale down, while in software development we are trying to scale up. So what's the agenda for today? I'll start with why I start talking about Agile risk management. It's in quotes because I don't believe that there is such thing. It's risk management, like Agile, it's Agile, it's agnostic. That's why I like this group. There is no Agile as a Scrum, Agile as a Safe, Agile as a DAD. And then I had a few questions on the group prior to the meetup about what's the difference between uncertainty, risk, and probability and all that kind of stuff. Then the main topic is bridging the gap between enterprise risk and Agile team risk. And in conclusion, why I think this risk management is important in Agile. And of course, the fun bit, which is the questions. This is a code that I found in, I think, 3 years ago when I had another talk about risk in Agile. And it's probably the way a lot of Scrum Masters and developers see what a project manager does in terms of risk management. And it's very funny for me as a PM to find out that a Scrum Master or a developer thinks that I spend all my day talking about risk. It's not about that. It's not about writing down risk. It's about managing them as part of what the PM does. And in a small team, like a Scrum team, it is team's responsibility. But at the end of the day, somehow there should be some visibility and responsibility on managing risks. And it's good to know that other people, they spend very little time doing those things which are very not important or whatever, which is again wrong. Risk management is very, very important. I found this in a very popular poster about Agile, and why I start laughing whenever I see this picture, it's because the author doesn't even have idea what it's in mathematics, cost versus time. On the right side, the so-called Agile, which is incremental, which again, incremental is not necessarily Agile, it's just incremental. The value of the risk is still high. If you look on the graph, the last triangle is still a high cost over some long time. There is no difference between the two graphs, apart from the fact that there are some arrows. Then waterfall, it's classified as faith-driven development, which again, it's wrong. It's the opposite. Waterfall, it's something that it's very planned. They try to be very precise. They want to know everything upfront. While Agile, you have faith, but you have faith in a good way. You start and then you adapt as you go. So this is a very popular poster with a lot of other mistakes, and it's not good for the people that are coming into the Agile movement to start with this very wrong impression. And then we have a lot of graphs that tells us how the risk moves in waterfall and in Agile. Very funny for whoever knows from where the left graph comes. It has nothing to do with risk. The right one, it's again a sort of fairy tale or misinterpretation. Then we have a lot of shapes for this risk between, depending on how much people like or doesn't like the waterfall. It's a very huge drop on the left on the risk. So the risk, it's constant throughout the project. And then at the end, bang, it's zero, which is again very weird for somebody who knows about project management, which I assume waterfall is traditional project management, because that's the job of the PM, to manage risk. So risk can't be linear. It will go up and down. For people that drew these graphs, risk never gets zero at the end of the project. Some risk will never be closed. So the risk will stay in the product itself or the outcome of the project. Then I start looking at things that are a bit more formal and let's say more a bit scientific. In the Scrum guide, the authors, they say that using Scrum, you optimize predictability and control risk. For me, I'm not disagreeing with them, but it's just weird that they speak about optimizing predictability in Agile, when the whole purpose of Waterfall was to be very predictive. Another statement that I disagree with them is that the sprints also limit risk to one calendar month of cost. It's nice on paper, it could be true on paper, but reality is that you can do something very bad in the last sprint that will basically stop the product working and then you can't release, or you miss the go live date by 2 weeks, and in that 2 weeks your competitor launches a product that will take the market. So it's not as easy as you lost only the cost of 5 to 9 developers in 1 month. And very risky from the risk point of view, decisions are made based on perception. And that's very, very bad. We shouldn't take decisions based on perceptions. We should take decisions based on information that is valid. So I'm sorry, but even the Scrum guide authors or the Scrum authors got few things wrong in the real life. So this presentation is about something new. And as we all know in Agile, whenever we come up with something new, people say, it's nice, looks good on paper, but it won't work because it was never done before. I had an experience in my career when we proposed a new system, a new platform, a content management system for a website. And one of the enemies of the project came up with the number of Google hits on .NET Nuke that was around for 5 to 10 years. And the new product, and they said, see, you can have find millions of hits about this old product and nobody's talking about the new one. So it's not good. This is a slide that I use in my other presentations for PMI, for Project Management Institute. It's just highlighting that there was a movement in manufacturing called Agile that started basically in 1970s when the US Army found out that manufacturing can't adapt to their needs fast enough. So they asked for some new types of toys. And the answer was we need 3 to 4 years from the concept to actual production. And there was a group at some university with 50 big companies participating, trying to find ways to become agile in manufacturing. So it was called the Agile Group in 90s. And this group defined a lot of principles that are valid everywhere, not only in manufacturing. Very interesting for software development was that kind of agile in manufacturing was defined as mass customization, which is exactly what we do now in software development. We have products that through configuration, they can meet requirements of multiple customers. Of course, everybody knows that 2001, the Manifesto for Agile Software Development, wrongly called the Agile Manifesto, was published. My view as a practitioner and a guy who was around at that time is that it's not that much because of the manifesto. It's more because a lot of people were trying less formal things in software development. And a lot of teams found the need to have a bit more formal approach to their cowboy development. So XP came very good as a way of doing things in an agile way, but a bit formal. Maybe it was too formal for what people expected. Maybe it came too early. I do believe that XP was in a way better than Scrum. And a lot of practices from XP survived in Scrum, story points, burn down chart, peer development, but people forgot that there was a such framework. And then once we go towards 2010 and later, Agile becomes a trend. It's a fashion. It's a very nice label to have on your business card if you have one on your profile. I believe that we reached the peak of what was the Agile Manifesto Agile, and we can see now that the so-called scaled frameworks, they are basically a return back to Lean, which was exactly what Agile wanted to replace. And if they say or they don't say, a lot of Lean practices that come from 40s are now used in Agile, which is not wrong. So a lot of people also think that Agile is risk management. So we move to Agile, we move to Scrum, and everything is fine. What some people don't know is why Agile tried to replace Lean. Lean came up with a lot of good tools and practices to improve quality. So there are a lot of graphs with cost of quality. If you find the defect early in the process, it will be cheaper to fix and blah, blah, blah. What Lean was very hard to do, it's released to the market fast. So the process was so perfect, less of waste, less than 4 defects per 1 million opportunities, that when somebody tried to put a new feature or to change the scope of that service, it was almost impossible to adapt. So the cost of delaying to the market became in many cases higher than the cost of the quality of the product. If you come with a product late in the market or too early in the market, then you basically lose a lot of money. And again, another example that I advise people to watch, there is a documentary about a company called General Magic. I was flying somewhere and I just saw, you know, you have a lot of time in the plane from Australia. And I saw, you know, the most influential company in Silicon Valley that nobody heard of. I was one of the people that never heard of that company. It's a shocking documentary. How some people try to build a mobile phone too early for the market, and how people on the market, on the street, they said, we will never pay $1,000 for something that will sit with us all the time. So it bothers us all the time, and see where we are now. There are people with 2-3 phones in their pocket. So speaking of risk, on these two graphs, in both cases, there is risk, and I'll explain a bit later what risk really means. With the cost of quality, there is a positive risk. If we take a risk to release sooner, with not so good quality, people will whinge a bit, but they will buy the product, will get money back. And as Peter Drucker said, the business of business is to stay in business. If we don't get money, we don't stay in business. And there is a risk of being too perfect and releasing, and that documentary, it's all about how perfect that product they wanted to be. If we are too late in the market, the peak of our profit would be much lower than even when the product was not so perfect. This is something that I think fits the best in agnostic Agile from all the groups that I've seen. It's what is the combination between Agile and Lean? So I wanted to prove that I read the manifesto of agnostic Agile. So I translated the manifesto, which is a proof that I read the document. I did the same with the Scrum guide. So I have a proof that I read both documents. What is different from the green stuff that was the Lean Enterprise to the Agile Enterprise is that now we should be risk friendly. We should take risks, because without risk, like in gambling, there is no reward. And the other thing that it's changed now, we are also change friendly. We embrace change as per the Agile Manifesto. We don't try to standardize to be perfect. But everything else that it's in black still applies. And instead of standardizing, which was the bottom part, we have now processes that evolve as we think that it's necessary. And the whole enterprise, it's adaptable. So can adapt to any changes in the market, to any demands, to anything that may change in technology and so on. This was how Lean was presented before. So it's all about good people, which is nothing against Agile. You have flow, which a lot of people now present the flow as the new step in Agile. Kanban is the new thing instead of Scrum and other frameworks. You get very good quality, you eliminate waste, you have a lot of cost saving, and then of course the customer is happy, you sell more, and you have a lot of cost saving. So this was the thinking in 70s, 80s, when a product will last for 3 years, 5 years, 9 years. Now you buy a phone and you may replace it after 6 months. So people start thinking also about agility. You adapt to market fast. You come fast to the market. And of course, you have more customers, first of all. Satisfied or not satisfied, at some point it's irrelevant how long they bought your product. You have more sales, and of course you have more return on investment. It's fantastic, it's very good. I think safe and disciplined Agile can fit very well in this picture, but everything comes with risk. And it's red and green because risk is, it could be an opportunity or it could be a loss. Everything that it's continuous change, it's a risk. We do that change without knowing what will happen. Otherwise, we go back to plan and tradition and what is called waterfall and so on. So bringing agility in the picture, in the enterprise, will put at risk the flow, will put at risk the quality. There'll be more waste. When people think that Agile comes with less waste, it's wrong. Prototyping, it's a waste, but it's a good waste because you'll recover that loss later. And in my view, in my experience, Agile is never cheaper than a planned approach. It just gives you the best product that you can get in that amount of money and time. And of course, time to market, sometimes you can be too soon. It puts stuff at risk and so on. So this is another example for Scrum Masters that are very optimistic with what Scrum can do in terms of managing risk. It's the famous with risk only one sprint, no loss, a few thousand dollars. It's good. I had a project that involved three Scrum teams. We had three mobile applications to develop, and to mitigate the risk, that organization choose to engage three different startups to develop the application. So there were three versions of the application. It was a mobile application monitoring the transport to the trains, you know, when they come. So we provided the feed, the data feed to these three teams, and they start developing their very nice mobile applications with maps, with the train is coming in 5 minutes, it's late and so on. It was a very good idea for whoever had the guts to put three times the budget, because this was the real program. It was that small application that 3 to 5 people in each team developed. But then it was the whole procurement process around buying thousands of mobiles, about modifying the uniform to have the holsters for the mobiles, to do a lot of change management, to teach people what they do with that application. The idea was that people will get out of their offices and sit on the platform and speak with the customers. So a lot of changes that were around this very, let's say, small mobile application developed in 2-3 months. And of course, providing the data feed. Then there was another project, the gray guy, that was doing similar things with tablets. So other applications that were for the tablets for people, the guards in the train. Of course, we had a program manager. Of course, we had the PMO. And there was a big transformation program in the business that was coordinating many more other projects. And funny enough, I had a lot of time. I had to have a lot of time for the enterprise risk management team because at that scale, the risks to the organizations were pretty high. And one of the risks that they put in their risk register was using Agile to build these products. So Agile doesn't come at a low risk and so on. In many cases, it's the opposite. When we promoted this webinar, and thank you again, Ivona and Adrian, we had a chat on LinkedIn, on the group in LinkedIn, and I got a lot of questions about uncertainty is risk and risk is uncertainty and so on. I found this book that is published in 1921, and even that time, the author knew that risk and uncertainty are two different topics. And he's a PhD, and I think PhDs are always smart. What people thought in these times, in the 20s, 30s, 40s, up to even 80s, is that risk is always negative. We should always eliminate, mitigate, minimize risk. There is a new way of looking at risk in the risk management community that took out that negative outcome. But the two other characteristics are still valid. So we call risk something that may happen, not something that it's a fairy tale or something similar in the negative way. And we always have a choice to action, to do something with that stuff that may happen. Uncertainty is it's the doubt of the people when they try to understand something, and in relation with Agile is knowledge. Agile is based on knowledge, and the Agile enterprise in manufacturing was defined as a knowledge enterprise. That concept comes also in the Team Agile, Software Agile. We need to learn, we need to be multi-skills, that wrong thing, T-shape and so on. But that's from where the uncertainty comes, from the lack of knowledge. A lot of people associate probability with risk, which is good on paper, but we don't have enough information either for predictive approaches to use probability to determine the likelihood. And according to risk professionals, it's much better to just have sort of qualitative, maybe it's very likely, unlikely, almost certain, so you never go to certain. And risk, basically, it's not what they said that time. It's a bit different these days, and we'll get there. And now about this, how do we manage risk in Agile, in Agile projects? There are three ways that are the most common. The left side, it's a screenshot from AtRisk, a program or software that tells you what is the probability of what will happen, may happen, based on some very nice formulas. It's very good, but you need very specialized skills, you need a lot of data, and it was very interesting that this kind of tools were used during COVID. They went back to what Six Sigma does, the probability, the bell curve. Then every organization that manages projects or has the concept of projects will have a risk register that becomes fancier and fancier, but nobody looks at it. And then something that for me it's weird and doesn't make a lot of sense, it's the risk burn down chart that looks similar with the normal burn down chart. And so far in my experience, I haven't seen yet a burn down chart that nice. I have a few examples that are like a sort of joke. There are many reasons for the normal burn down chart to be weird. According to risk management, risk will never go down that linear. So what is the problem that I wanted to solve, or we want to solve? First of all, it's the misalignment between people that are doing risk management outside the software development or projects, and the focus on the projects, what the project needs, and what the focus it's for the product. Scrum, it's a product development, it's not a project management framework. And we have three different views: product, project, and business. And most of the time they are not aligned, because most of the time the people from the other sides, they don't even know how a Scrum team manages risk, or the Scrum team doesn't know what enterprise risk means. And one of the causes is the vocabulary. We use uncertainty, we use probability, we use a lot of terms that are not used by the other teams. Then severity levels are completely different between different layers in the organization. You speak with a developer and you said, no, we lose $1 million if you don't do this. So $1 million, my God, is $1 million. You go a bit above to even a department manager, and $1 million, it's a risk that they will take. They had a lot of losses with $1 million losses. And it's not very clear who is responsible for what when it comes to risk management. There is this idyllic view that the team is responsible for everything, which basically means that nobody is responsible for anything. Risk is always bad. It's not a risk. It's perceived as risk management as a difficult and rigid process. The famous waterfall applies to risk. And I had a conversation recently with somebody who didn't even know that waterfall, it's a software development methodology or method or whatever. It's a framework, basically. And in his origins, in the paper, it's far more agile than many frameworks. Basically, for what the Scrum team does, there are only two steps: design and build. So it's not rigid. It shouldn't be rigid. If people are making it rigid, it's because the people are wrong, not the process is wrong. Risk management, it's always perceived as not necessary in Agile. Agile is risk management. You don't need everything. It's risk. Whenever you do anything you do, there is a risk, small or big. And in projects, everybody thinks that this is a mumbo jumbo that the PM should do for the PMO and for the sponsor. And we are technical people. We are very smart. We don't need to get involved. And the big problem is that when the risk management is pushed to one person only, then there is no collaboration, basically. And that poor guy who is the responsible, whatever his title is, he can't delegate the activities, the actions to other people, because nobody wants to get involved. What is a solution? So not the solution. I should change that title. It's one framework that is for the whole enterprise, for the whole company. And in many cases these days, because we speak about networking, about partners, that integration should extend beyond our organization. But inside the organization, there should be a single view between business, project, and product teams. We should use the same terms. We should understand that you can't eliminate risk. That's a fairy tale. I've seen companies that put zero defects in the product, which again, it's another thing. Nobody can do a release without zero product in software, zero defects. And understand this positive side of the risk, which is for some people new. And understand that when we speak about embracing change, it means that we embrace risk. And we do need to adapt the traditional risk management to Agile. And we need to share, which is the whole agility, collaboration, and so on. For people that are not aware, I just put a slide about risk management standards. So there are international standards that are dealing with the risk management. There is one that is called COSO. And it's, let's say, more or less financial risk. It's at the top of the organization. It's used by the boards, by people, investors, and so on, to manage risk, the process. There is another standard that it's ISO 31000. It's a standard that originated from an Australian standard, and I'm very proud of that. I work with a few people that developed that standard. And it was initially defined for safety. And when we think about safety comparing with software development, it's a big difference between somebody getting hurt and a line of code that makes the screen blue instead of light blue. PMI developed their own risk management standard, which is, in my view, a bit weird that you have an international standard and you try to do your own standard. And at the Scrum team, there is no standard. So basically, it's only that small sentence in the Scrum guide. I haven't seen any risk management approach in other frameworks, SAFe, DAD, and so on. So the new approach is that the whole organization to, and this is not my view, this is from COSO, and it's at least, I think, yeah, 2017. They said that when they revamp the whole standard, the organization needs to be more adaptive to change. This is speaking in the context of risk management. So it's not the Agile manifesto. And they think that risk should be aligned with the modern economy, with the market, how dynamic the market is changing, and so on. And the risk management helps to optimize outcomes. Remember, this is at the board level. So they think that risk is good to optimize the outcome. And risk management, it's across the organization now. It's no longer something that there is a team, a risk manager, that it's a senior manager, GM risk or whatever, and he has a team and they just do risk registers. And of course, risk management is more than a list. It's something that you use to do something good for the company, for the product. And this is very aligned with the Agile manifesto, because we always should have new ways. I don't see how Agile can be prescriptive. You have to do this because the Scrum guide said, you have to do this because the training, the trainer said, the coach said, and so on. You have to clap your hands at the stand-up because this is what you learn in the training course. It's empirical, and this is one thing that, again, we had a lot of conversation with Adrian about coaches. I don't understand how somebody who never did product, never worked on the product, never had the responsibility of a product, software or not, can be a good Agile coach, because Agile, it's empirical, it's team-based, it is light documentation, no longer that long risk register that nobody's looking at it. And the last but not least, the value that I really believe that is true, the value Agile, it's responding to change over following a plan, and people don't read that following a plan means that you still have a plan, but it's just a baseline. You don't follow the plan. This is COSO. So this is the latest version. When they come like a cycle with the PDCA cycle and so on, and you can see the green stuff. They do align with Agile very much. They speak about the culture, they speak about objectives, improvement, and it's one of their core things is leverage information and technology. So this is what modern Agile started, software development Agile. It's all about information technology and using that information technology for the good of the organization or the people. This is the other standard, so the ISO 31000. They also have principles. All of them are very agile. They also have a framework, which is very light now. There's nothing prescriptive on how you manage risk. And the three green areas that I highlighted, they do apply to any development team, product development team. It's just the part in the middle, how you do risk, you assess, you mitigate, you treat, blah, blah. That part in Agile, it's a bit different. It's not that formal, but you still need to monitor and review the risks, which is what we do in the stand-ups. You still need to communicate and consult above the Scrum team when the risk is too big. And the most important part that it's missed in many presentations that I've seen about risk in Agile, it's established the context. People jump on finding risk without knowing why we find these risks or what we do with them. And it's coming back to we find best solution for the wrong problem. That is very common in software development. By the way, I am an ex-software developer, so I can speak bad about the practice. That establishing the context, it's what people miss even when they start beating the waterfall. They don't put defining requirements at the first step. They go straight to design. First of all, you need to know what you want to do and why you want to do that stuff. This is a sort of picture of how an organization that is not software development looks like and where the risks are. We always look at Scrum in a small software team that it's a five people. I had some numbers in a different presentation. We had basically three people doing software development in that organization, 5,000 people in the core business doing manufacturing, and the whole IT was 150 people, most of them operational, taking care of emails, taking care of databases, patching products, and so on. So whatever can apply in terms of risk management to a team of, let's say, 10 people, it's hard to believe that that kind of principle and knowledge can be spread across 5,000. And this is valid not only for risk management, it's also valid for Agile. This push from software development to the whole organization, I think it's wrong. And people should adapt both sides, not being pushed from one. So we need a common understanding. I won't read the bad ones. I'll read only the green. Risk is basically the effect of uncertainty on objectives. So it's not the uncertainty itself. It's what can happen because we don't know everything that may happen. This is a pyramid that it's inspired from health and safety. They had a lot of research on incidents and risks and problems. And what was very interesting for me when I seen first time in an organization, we were implementing a risk management software. They were looking at unsafe acts, like the 1,000 acts that are absorbed, the risks, to find out, because there is a proportion between the number of unsafe acts or minor incidents to the fatality. So there is a proportion, there is a number, and if you really find 1,000 unsafe acts and then you identify around 15, let's say medium incidents like injury, then you can be sure that your process is not good enough and you may have a fatality. I adapted that thing with Fibonacci because you all like Fibonacci, and just keep, you know, it's fun from mathematical point of view, but it fits the science. So we do have a lot of risks that are, some people don't even know about them, but they are absorbed by the team, they are accepted, nothing happens. Then we have some risk where we use contingency, not necessarily money. We use the estimation time, that padding that we put, because we don't know how difficult is that stuff. There will be some risk, which in this case it's somewhere around, let's say, 5-10, that will require some help, not necessarily money, but you can add a developer from somewhere else, you can ask help from the architects, you can help ask help from the DBA in software. And then of course there are risks that will become issues and will deliver less in the sprint or in the product, and sometimes so one in 1,000 cases will have a failure. This is how I see the joining of risk management responsibilities in a company. So the Scrum team, I put some numbers, so don't take them as low because I don't have any data to support them. But I think what the risks that may happen in one or two sprints, and it's a 1,000 loss, so 3,000 to 10,000, I think a Scrum team can manage, and they shouldn't ask for help. But then when that Scrum is part of a project, and you can go in projects up to millions, these are real projects, not three people working on a mobile application, then that can go to up to 10 sprints. So 10 sprints, you lose every sprint 100,000, that's a million. The PM should be able to manage that. The moment it goes to some big values, you go to the steering committee or to the PMO and ask them for help. And of course, when things are really big, it's the enterprise that should get involved. What was important for this presentation was the concept of risk capacity and the risk appetite. And if we are in a Scrum team and that appetite is not at the top, so very close to the maximum that we can manage at the team level, I don't believe that the team is that agile. So when people are avoiding risk, they don't even comply with the Agile manifesto. And we do need to put that capacity to absorb risk at the team level, so we know when that risk should be escalated for help to other people. Every risk management book will tell you that there are strategies to mitigate, to optimize, to exploit, to whatever. What they don't tell you is that there should be a consistent view on these strategies. And depending on the value that you put on that risk, it can go to the program, to the project, to the portfolio. So to explain the triangles, we accept a lot of risks in the Scrum team, in the project team, in the program team. We don't even speak about them. We don't even put them in the risk register or wherever. And they are there. They are accepted. But they are there. They are risks in the big scheme of things. There are some risks that can be identified even at the Scrum team. The line is very thin, the very dark triangle. There are risks in the Scrum, let's say, project with codes that will impact the enterprise. We can have an application that it's so strategically important for the organization that if we fail delivering that application on time, so it's not about bugs, it's about failing the whole application. It will have impact that will go straight to the board, to the CEO of that company. This is my recommendation, and this is what I do with Scrum teams when I do Scrum. So same proportion of risk that can be absorbed. If people think that something is a risk, it may happen and it may impact us, or we should take that risk, just stick a post-it on this board. I don't use software. I use real boards because it's not, we don't have that many. And then as a team in the stand-up, when somebody puts that sticky note whenever they like, we move the sticky note as a team in one of the four areas. So either we leave them in the just monitoring, sorry, accepting, or we put to monitor to see if something happened. We take some actions, we put in the backlog. Again, backlog, another concept that it's misunderstood. The backlog is not only user stories, it's everything that you do to develop the product. And if it's something that we can't handle, we put in that red square, and it's my duty, either as a PM and Scrum Master or as just Scrum Master, to go to the PM, to the program manager, and ask for help. And from that board, that it's very easy to be understood and used by, it's not a Kanban, it's just a board. I speak with the PM, or I am the PM, I put that stuff in the risk register because that's the way people above a Scrum team look at risk. If they look, it will always be a risk register, and the senior people will jump to the red flag risks and they'll say, what are you doing? Instead of asking what you want us to do to help you. But that will be the visibility across the organization from the Scrum team up to the people managing risk through risk register. And I got to the conclusion. One framework, collaboration rather than hierarchy, develop the culture, and most of them are valid for Agile, not only for risk management. Empower the Scrum team to manage risk. So they should be the ones deciding if we accept, if we mitigate, if we do whatever we do, not somebody from above telling them that give me 10 risks. I've seen so-called risk workshops when everybody in the room should define one risk, or lesson learned when everybody in the room should tell us one problem that we face. Nobody's telling about good things. Tell me a problem. Yes, risk is a reality. It should be managed. It should be simple process, not this formal 200 pages policies and procedures that nobody reads. And when I speak with risk professionals, risk management professionals, they should also learn from what was good and is still good in Agile, the adaptation, embracing change as an opportunity for success. And risk as a framework should be very clear defined in an organization. So the risk management team should define the framework, the culture, the risk appetite, so how much risk as an organization we take. Then in the project, PM knows pretty well, if he's a real PM, what to do with risk management. The bit that in terms of Agile, it's important for me is that the Scrum team should be aware that Agile, it's risk. Any change means risk, and the risk should be managed. And I apologize because this is my view, so it's not agnostics Agile's view, but based on the manifesto, I think we are on the same page. I think we should look at the Agile manifesto a bit different. We should value both sides, right or left, and we should use the practices from either side as we see fit in the context. And to do that, it's very important to know all of them. So people that are so-called waterfall PMs, traditional project managers, traditional teams, they should look at Agile and understand how they can use it. But on the other side, the Agile people, they should look what was done before, because people like Adrian and myself, we made a lot of mistakes. We have a lot of scars. It's a bit silly to repeat the same mistakes now. So everybody should do his own mistakes, learn new things, rather than just repeat what people did in the last 30, 40 years.